Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for joining this evening for Reckoning with Racism, how small arts organizations can be a force for change in classical music, with five incredible panelists and hosted by Victoria Gao, the artistic director and conductor of Capital City Symphony. I'm Margaret Bushko. I'm the executive director of Capital City Symphony, and I'm so glad you guys are all here with us this evening. For those of you who aren't familiar with Capital City Symphony, or CCS, we're a community orchestra based here in Washington, D.C. We are founding arts partners of the Atlas Performing Arts Center on H Street Northeast, and the upcoming season will be our 53rd season. Like many arts organizations, our performing schedule has been impacted by the coronavirus pandemic, but we'll be staying connected to our musicians and audience members in various ways. With that, I'm going to turn it over to our host, Victoria Gao.
Hello, everyone, and welcome. It's so exciting to see so many people here from so many different places for this very important topic. We have a fantastic panel tonight of really, really wonderful people, and I'd like to introduce each one of them. Vincent Danner is the former associate conductor of the Memphis Symphony and former conductor of the Memphis Youth Symphony. He's made guest appearances with the Dallas, Charleston, and Atlanta Symphonies, among others, and has served on the faculties of Oberlin Conservatory and Baldwin-Wallace University. We're extremely grateful to Vince for serving as a consultant and helping us to plan this event. Dr. William LaRue Jones is professor of music and director of orchestral studies and opera at the University of Iowa, as well as the music director of the Ottumwa Symphony. An active guest conducting career has taken him around the world, including extensive guest conducting in Asia. He has conducted twice as many all-state orchestras as there are states in the Union. Think about that. And trained numerous music educators and conductors, including four of us here today. In an earlier incarnation, Dr. Jones served as principal bassoon of the Minnesota Opera and Ballet and played frequently with both the Minnesota Orchestra and the St. Paul Chamber Orchestra. Chelsea Tipton II is principal pops conductor of the New Haven Symphony Orchestra and music director of the Symphony of Southeast Texas. He's the former resident conductor of the Toledo Symphony and associate conductor of the Savannah Symphony. He's appeared as guest conductor with the NSO, Cleveland Orchestra, Detroit Symphony, and many more. Carlos Simon is an award-winning composer and assistant professor at Georgetown University. His latest album, My Ancestor's Gift, was released on Navona Records in 2018. His recent commissions come from, just to name a few, the Philadelphia Orchestra, the Washington National Opera, Reno Philharmonic, the American Composers Orchestra, and quite a lot more. Simon has previously served on the faculties of Spelman and Morehouse Colleges. Veronica Jackson is a violinist and the recently named orchestra director of the school that is currently named T.C. Williams High School, hopefully soon to be renamed. Prior to that, she taught middle school in Alexandria and both high school and middle school in Richmond, Virginia and Raleigh, North Carolina. She is a highly sought after clinician and conductor of regional orchestras and has conducted several adult orchestras in the DC area and played in others, including CCS. So we want to go straight into our questions, and we're going to start with you, Vince. This panel came about from some really intense conversations that you and I had, both this summer and in past years, many years in the past. You've shared some things with us about your experience in Memphis, and which would shock some people and sadly not be surprising in the least to others. Would you be willing to share a bit with us about your experiences?
Sure. Thanks for the question, and it's really great to be here. The very first thing was, you know, I got to Memphis in August of 1995, and I was presented with a an article that appeared in the then commercial appeal. I think it was the first part of August in that month. Anyway, the caption to the announcement that the orchestra had hired a new assistant conductor was "Black named assistant conductor." And I was very fortunate that the letter "black" had a capital letter, because you know that I must have been elevated to a certain level in society at that point. But that's how I was greeted, and that caption pretty much summed up in so many different ways the experience that I had there, both good and bad. And about a month later, and I just pass this on before getting into a couple of things, but about a month later, I had an interview with a very formidable lady. Her name was Sharon Dobbins, and I think those of you who are from Memphis will probably remember that name. But Sharon was an Oberlin College Conservatory graduate of the early 70s, and she was a phenomenal writer. She wrote for the Black publication, which is the Tri-State Defender. And I remember during my interview, when we were finished, She always had this way. She was one of those who was just upfront with you. She told you what you needed to hear. And I remember that finger coming. And she said to me, "Maestro Danner, you need to know, you are a highly educated Black man. You are a threat. You are a danger. And you need to watch your back." And that sent chills up my spine. But then the longer I stayed, and as well as, you know, just going around and just living, I really began to understand what she said. She did explain what she meant. It didn't register to me at the moment. It was just a little overwhelming. But some of my experiences were, you know, just on a personal level. Like I had a Pops concert that I did, and an audience member came up to me afterwards, and she was a very, very nice lady. I don't even remember who she was. And she said, "Oh, it was a great concert, and you spoke so well." And I thought, huh, okay. And again, not clicking. It bothered me. And then I remember another situation where I had a player who came to me in all sincerity and pretty much said, "You know, I hope you really leave here and just do more Black music. You really are enthusiastic." And I thought, again, not registering. It's not clicking with me, you know. And then another incident that I can remember was we were contracted to play for, I believe it was the NAACP Freedom Awards ceremony at the Cannon Arts Center. And I was assigned to do the one piece that we were doing. I had no part in the planning, but just a few minutes before I'm going out on stage, one of my superiors, you know, white male, and another white male whom I did not recognize, both of whom proceeded to tell me that I needed to speak to the audience and what I needed to say, verbatim. I didn't take very kindly to that. I got into my headspace. I got real defiant, quite frankly. And I walked out, and you know, I did what I did, and that was that. So many of the experiences that I have had are just kind of like underneath the skin. I can safely say that, and I don't want to, you know, piss too many people off, but you know, the thing that I found about Memphis was that I was a part of a white elitist arts organization that found itself in the crosshairs of the Old South and the New South, existing within a plantation mentality, right? And that was still trying to come to terms with its part in the history of the civil rights and the sanitation worker strike and so on and so on. So that was a lot. I was just not prepared for that. I was focusing just on the artistic side of myself. But needless to say, you know, you get, and I'm sure the conductors have experienced this, you can see attitudes that sometimes comes at me or comes at you on the podium. You can see the reaction. You can see when we're doing MLK concerts or Black History Month concerts, we'll talk about it a little bit later. You could see that the uncomfortability, I think, at times. But also, this was an organization that had huge perception problems in a city that was predominantly African American, and it maintained that elitist mindset. So, I'll kind of just like you know leave it there. So,
I
And so I think it's really useful to have a sense of context for grounding what we can hope, what will hopefully be able to be as much of a forward-looking conversation, but we can't look forward without being fully aware of where we have been and where we still are in many ways. Dr. Jones, I'd like to turn things to you. As somebody who's trained and inspired any number of music educators and conductors, can you speak a little bit about your experience teaching that next generation of artistic leaders? Have you seen changes in that area over the years? And what changes do you feel could still take place?
Well, first of all, thank you, Victoria, for putting this all together and for inviting me. And what an honor it is to be on a panel with all of my former conducting students and my new friend, Carlos, the composer. One of the things that I think is very important, not only what you bring artistically, but what you bring from a social standpoint visually. And I know what Vince is talking about was groundbreaking. Problematically so for Vince, but for the community, there are a lot of people that became aware of someone's talents they may not have given credit to before. So as far as teaching conducting, I don't think our job really is just to teach the gestural refinement. That you can teach in a matter of hours. Now, it may take a lifetime to know how to apply it, when to apply it, because the repertoire all changes and it all has different kinds of needs and constraints. But the physical aspect of it can be taught. What you can't teach has to do with the person themselves, the charisma, someone wanting to follow you when you stand on a podium. And as we know, women and blacks have had a very difficult time being invited to the podiums of orchestras in this country. We can remember the name of Dean Dixon, maybe some of you would, in the middle of the 19th century, not 19th century, 1900s. Antonio Brico, the woman that Sibelius praised for conducting his second symphony, could not conduct in this country until she actually created an orchestra, an all-women's orchestra in Denver. Dean Dixon spent his entire career in Europe. So it's important and rewarding to see the number of women and minority conductors that we are now experiencing. What we try to do is teach people how to get inside the music, get into it in a way that they end up being taking ownership of it. And when they step on the podium, they're conducting it as if they composed it themselves. That's the depth of knowledge that we hope to instill in every student, as well as to continue to do ourselves. We have to continue to revisit scores over and over, even if we've conducted them dozens of times. You always find something new that you should be able to bring out of that score. And we also must seek out new repertoire. Repertoire that is, or the ink is basically still fresh on the page. Meet the young conductors, young composers that are creating these works. Speak to them, try to understand the new language. Because for a lot of us, all of our background was only Eurocentric repertoire. And not all of the interpretive aspects apply. No. Notes, rhythms, dynamics, that's what we have to get beyond and get inside the music as much as we can. When we talk about, and that doesn't mean we ignore the historically significant canon of music that orchestras play. We just have to become inclusive in how we do our programming. I find students have an opportunity today that is much better to be informed than when I was a student. We didn't have computers and the internet. You had to go to the score and study the score and develop an interpretation. Now, we did have LPs. For people that don't know what those are great big old round. but what you would have is maybe one recording of the Brahms second. You can go on YouTube now and see the finest conductors in the world conducting the finest orchestras playing the repertoire at the highest possible level, and you can just keep going down the line and you can find 10, 15 orchestras playing the same repertoire. That's a big advantage. Music libraries are much better now. The old card catalogs are gone. You can find things instantaneously. They're much more, much better prepared and equipped than when I was a student. So I think the students do have a big advantage at this point, but it's also a disadvantage. They can be lazy, and they can end up listening to recordings and just then basically become a poor imitation of what they heard. So we have to encourage them to listen to any number of recordings. We still need to be informed. I don't say don't listen, but I say study, and then develop your own interpretation. So you're an authentic person yourself, not just someone that imitates or emulates someone else. Teaching conducting is, I think for the future, is a delicate balance. We want to impart on our students stylistically correct, whatever that word might be, interpretation. We want them to know the difference in articulation and style of a Baroque to a classical to a romantic to contemporary work. But we also have to make sure that we know when to release the reins, give them the freedom to run. They're going to make mistakes, and they'll learn greatly by doing so. They won't learn as long as we're holding on to them too tightly. So the only way to sustain a career is having your own voice.
That's fabulous. Dr. Jones, thank you so much. I think that answers pretty clearly why so many of us keep coming back to study with you as often as we possibly can. I'm going to move things to Chelsea Tipton now. Chelsea, since 2009, you've been music director of the Symphony of Southeast Texas. Are there specific efforts that you've made there to help that orchestra be more reflective of its community? And how have those efforts been received? And I'll extend that same question to New Haven, if you've been involved in similar initiatives there.
Well, you know, one of the things that I've worked on here has been getting the audience as diverse and looking at different ways to be inclusive of the entire community. About half the community here is African American, 49%, and trying to get that to be represented in the audience. Before I continue to answer the question, we did get a question from Serena Robbins, and she said, with some people blaming the lack of diversity in classical music on tradition or the industry, how do you suggest breaking that cycle? And I just want to share her question because my answer is going to have my approach to addressing that question. the biggest thing that I think is important for professional orchestras is that the board reflects the racial makeup of that community. You have a strong board, if you have a board that has a cross-section of the community as participants, it just opens up a lot of different avenues to the community. Making introductions to businesses that may have money, school organizations, making introductions to people who can come and enjoy the music. I always say, you know, we can do all the marketing we want to do. We can have the best marketing, TV ads, we can have social media, all those are great platforms, but the best marketing is the person that comes to a concert, has a great experience, and then tells someone that they should come and experience that orchestra or that choir or that band. So the board can be a very powerful influence, and especially in creating more diversity in the audience. The other thing is to go out into the schools. That's going to be very complicated this upcoming school year with the virus and everything, but it can be worked around. But having a voice, having a presence in the schools. I remember I grew up in Greensboro, North Carolina, and one of the most powerful experiences was in fourth grade when the North Carolina Symphony came to Greensboro and did their Young People's Concert, and it just had an incredible impact on me. So going out into the schools. And then the other thing is just getting out into the city. It's not enough for us to say that you need to come to us to hear the music. We have to be willing to go out, whether it's a chamber group that goes out into a school, whether it's a chamber orchestra that goes out and plays at a church or a community center. Those connections that are made are what we can draw people into the concert hall. Oftentimes what I find is when people come and see a concert, it's not what they think it is. They have this block. Unfortunately for orchestras, I think either Dr. Jones or Vince mentioned, there's an elitism that is associated with it that I think they like that. And so it's not for all the people. So I work very hard as a music director. I work very hard as a pops conductor. And every time I go up I live down in Beaumont, Texas, but I go up to New Haven four times a year to do their pops programs. I always, always go into the schools, go into the inner city schools and work with a band, orchestra, or a choir. Not as good with the choir, but I do what I can. And just having that presence. So in closing my portion, I think that the music director, the leader of that group, has to have a face in the community. One last thing, when I was in Toledo and I said I was moving to Beaumont, they're like, why are you moving to Beaumont, Texas? And I said, I wanted to be part of I wanted to see what that community was about. And the best way to do that is to be on the ground.
That's fantastic. Thank you.
Is that okay? Yeah. You want to wait to the end?
No, go ahead. Go ahead.
Yeah, I want to really piggyback off of what Chelsea said. You know, part of it too is recognizing, you know, asking the basic question, are we of this community or are we the community or are we from the community? You know, those are very different questions. And I think part of too the elitism is that, and I've experienced it and I've heard it from other audience members too through the years. They walk into this wonderful space and they feel not welcomed. There's an attitude or there's something that they are picking up that says, you know, what are you doing here? You know, or if I'm seeing something on stage that's telling me, okay, well, if they're bored, then why am I here? You know, and I think part of the other two about outreach is are we being really honest about our approach going out, or are we just doing it for some other reason? Because people do pick up on that. And the other thing with the educational component, and I'll just stop here because I won't take too much time. You know, with No Child Left Behind, what that policy taught was you can't do educational concerts or anything about sonata, allegro, or form. Nobody gives a flying whatever. You need to find ways to do cross-curricular approaches. That's number one. But number two is I always wanted to make sure that our teachers in our schools could see us as a resource. We're not the answer. We're not the end all be all. And we sometimes come across as, oh, come with us because we know everything, you know, blah, 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 blah. You know, we'll just have wine and cheese for the reception, you know, who cares, right? But we are a resource for you. Look at us as an extension of your classroom. If you're talking about music and math, music and technology, music and science, or starting in a string program, or whatever, right? We are here as a community to be of support to you. And I think we need to break down those barriers. And it's really about a level of comfort, because a lot of our admins are really people who are from the ivory tower, and they've never really lived in areas of diversity themselves. And that comes across even when they're speaking. So I just wanted to bring that up, just kind of piggyback up. Sorry about that.
Yeah, that's great. Actually, and speaking of breaking down barriers, I want to talk a little bit about another type barrier. You know, as we strive to do anti-racist work in at every level in the arts, programming is an area where community and small arts organizations can have an impact. So I'd like to kind of lob things over to Carlos Simon. You know, Carlos, for too long, I think the general assumption has been that there's a dearth of Black composers out there, and that is clearly couldn't be further from reality. Have you found in your career any situations where you've found that you were sort of knocking at a locked door, or having trouble getting past a perception barrier? And what do you think maybe that small arts organizations can do to sort of help to increase that diversity of representation?
Sure. Thanks for the question. Thank you for the opportunity to be here. Great platform. The composer, you know, what is that? You know, it's when I say that I'm a composer to people who are non-musicians, I get the deer in headlights look, like, oh, really? You know, you never... They never met a composer. And so I had to kind of explain what I do. This idea, even to musicians, you know, this composer, we think of the dead white males who are German, you know, Bach, Beethoven. And then you add in the layer of, okay, if you're a composer who's contemporary and new music, most conductors or performers are kind of shy away because they think you're off in the ivory tower somewhere, left field, and like you're composing music that's not accessible. And then you add the layer of being Black and African American, and then there's that assumption that you may not have the technical wherewithal. And composing it takes some a bit of craft, and especially with score. Makeup, that sort of thing. So there are a lot of things at play. And as an African-American composer who draws on gospel music and blues and jazz, you know, I grew up in the church, Pentecostal church. My dad's a preacher. And so I'm looking at one of the questions in the chat. This is Rebecca McLeod says, I would love to know what inspired all of you to pursue a professional career in music. And for me, it was church. You know, the music of the Black Pentecostal church, it's so rich. And I think it draws on, it is American culture. You know, you look at people like Aretha Franklin, Marvin Gaye, they all came out of the Black church. And I think as a composer who draws on these idioms, it can be particularly hard to work with conductors who don't know the performance practice of these Black idioms. You would never think of, as a conductor, performing Bach the same way as you would Brahms, right? So, like, I think we have to do work in understanding the performance idiom of Black music, you know? Yeah, these types of things are so important to sort of expanding the knowledge of American music, and essentially what it is. And I think so what small organizations can really do is to take some time to investigate local composers. It doesn't take much, you know, 30, 45 minutes, a phone call, just a Google search. Find out who your local composers are, even if it means researching your surrounding universities and saying, okay, hey, listen, is there a particular young composer that we can work with and mentor and invite your composers to, you know, performances and rehearsals? You know, I know that when I go to rehearsals or a performance, I know that I'm breaking the mold, if you will, of having, being alive for one, and then being an African-American male, and then being a millennial. I just made it by a couple of years. But you add those layers in, and then there's this knowledge of like re-educating, you know, what people think of a composer, what do you think of new music? And so I think we have to, as small organizations, you have to kind of do the work of finding your young composers and helping them and mentoring them. They need all the help they can get. You know, I remember being young and not having a track record, not having any recordings. You know, that it's so hard to say, listen, I have this piece of music, it was in my head, I think I know what it sounds like, but here is the music, you know, that some people are like, eh, I don't know. So I think we need to really be open-minded and proactive in finding, you know, your young composers.
Fantastic. Thank you, Carlos. Veronica, I want to bring it around to you. You've got the unique perspective in this group of having been involved as a playing member of CCS, and also having deep engagement with several other orchestras in the DC area. And also you have this perspective from what I call a rock star music educator. Yes. Can you speak to ways that orchestras in our area and specifically CCS can engage more meaningfully with color, communities of color and move towards being more reflective of our community?
Yeah, Vicki, so thank you again so much for hosting this event. Just looking at the panel, I can tell that, most of us, all of us had to probably started with a private teacher in a private studio with brand new instruments and perfectly tuned, parents who support you. No? Oh, so we must have all started in a public school situation. Okay, so I was wondering, what am I doing on the panel with the Dr. Jones? Well, he had to start somewhere. And like all of us, we had to start somewhere. So my place on this panel is representing every educator, the people who are in those classrooms every day, who are providing the instruction, the guidance, the leadership, all of the energy and the passion. Dr. McLeod, I can tell you it's public school education and being able to see teachers who are passionate about their craft. I can tell you that for most of my 29 years, okay, so for all of them, 29 years of teaching, I've just been super, super passionate. And I've always recognized my role as a Black woman, a Black female playing, first of all, violin in Eastern North Carolina. It's just an incredible responsibility that I welcomed. But it wasn't until you get into college and then realize that when you get into the teaching role that you understand that it's not just about being a Black woman. And you represent Black people as a whole from your classroom, in your classroom setting. So I've been able to do that in my classroom, starting in Wake County and in Henrico County. We had Black History Month programs that were, my former students are on here, they can tell you it was a predominantly white campus at Godwin High School, but I had an administration that was very supportive, and we were able to do a Black History Month program that traced the history of the African American from 1400 before they came over, and they were Africans who came over and were turned into slaves. So we were able to trace the history from then to present day, and we incorporated collaborated with the entire band, the entire orchestra, and we even incorporated in years later, used the trauma. So it was important to do that for the white school. I also took my orchestra students every year to play at my church, St. Paul's Baptist Church, which is a large church, probably 5,000 or 6,000, 7,000 members. And my students not only played at the church, and my pastor Lance Watson was so awesome to invite us and have us there. But not only did they play, they actually had a chance to sit in the audience. Now, these are students from suburban West End of Henrico County. Most had never been in a Black church, and they had only seen it, on TV. And I know that's a whole nother show, how the media portrays the media portrays Blacks in music. But it was quite an education. So now that I'm in Alexandria, we've been able to do a lot of collaborative things. My school is 75% Black and Hispanic, 75%. So I don't think before I got there 8 years ago that there was ever a Hispanic Heritage Assembly. We have Hispanic Heritage Month, the celebration nationally, but I don't think there was ever such an event. And I'm going to answer the question, but I think it's the context that I'm providing is knowing your community. With 42% of the students being Hispanic, I thought it was important. The teachers who are Hispanic at Hammond Middle School, they thought it was important, but they weren't in that performance mode, so they don't know. So they asked for our help. So we were able to start produce a Hispanic Heritage Assembly. We also, and because I am very excited about Black history, of course, our major concert and major performances that we gave is our Black History Month performance. I'm going somewhere with all of this. Again, the point I'm trying to make is just knowing your community and having the energy and the passion and the will to do so. So I'm not Hispanic. So what do I do? I do what Vicky has done today. We ask the question, how can we celebrate? What is the appropriate way to present, to celebrate Hispanics? Who do we celebrate? So I did make that connection with our staff over at Hammond Middle School, and they gave me lots and lots of information. So along with our band, choir, and orchestra, we produced this this assembly, and we've done it every year for the past almost 9 years. And the same with the Black History Month program. It has become a staple at our school. So when we are approached, and Vicky, your question about how can CCS do this? Well, it's all about, okay, CCS is a community orchestra. To me, community means diversity. And it also means accessibility. So with like secondary schools, it's y'all come ensembles. You know, we have to say everybody. So differentiation is the key. Inclusivity in auditions. So by way of auditions, here's an idea, something that community orchestras can do. When you advertise, as it's already been said, advertising, at area churches, of course. Churches is always a good place to start, but they're also recreation centers, gyms, childcare centers. Advertise about the availabilities. Parents who drop their kids off are always looking for somewhere else to go when they drop their kids off. We want to go play. We used to play, so we're ready to go and do what we love. So advertising in those areas. Another way that CCS and other community organizations can expand their reach. You can advertise on Black radio stations and actually doing some legwork, going to the local areas that surround your performance space.
okay? And I know that CCS has already done that. CCS has done a lot. And this is an idea I think that, and people that work with me, they know I have some ideas. I always have a lot of ideas. I do the most. I'm super passionate about this. Leveled auditions. So somebody comes in and they might not quite be ready to play, but maybe they'll be ready to play in the spring. And Vicky, you're uber organized. You know what you're going to play. So maybe a group of people can work with that person to get them ready to play maybe on the last concert. And that way they'll still feel connected, feel like somebody cares. The saying of people will never forget what, they will forget what you say or do, but they will never forget how you made them feel. In an audition, you welcome them and it's a whole, a feeling of inclusivity, right? And again, accessibility. Vicky, your question about how to engage more meaningfully with communities of color can also be recognized in your area of programming. DC Strings is a wonderful community organization that is doing what, it's a model organization that is already doing what we should all have been doing for all these years, what orchestras should have been doing. Andrew Lee has a great vision of bringing the music to all four quadrants of DC, taking the music to the people. And Vicky, I did take time to read CCS strategic plan, and I know that you've got those things and you all are already working on that, taking the concerts to the community. Very, very, very important to do that. And the cliché unity concert with, it's cliché, but it works. It works. It connects people together. My awesome community orchestra, Arlington Concert Orchestra, is, I think, all white. And it's just the way that a lot of the Arlington community is. But I think we can do a little better too. We can do a little better. But one thing that we did is partnered with the large church. Oh my goodness, what is the name of the church? The large church in Arlington, a large Black church. And we did a program together and it was amazing. I think it was the best concert that we've ever given. We partnered with that church and they were so excited to have us. We were excited to have the choir work with us. And it was just an amazing event. So again, addressing the whole question of yes, Mount Zion, that's the one. Thank you, Mount Zion Baptist Church. They were wonderful in Arlington, Virginia. Thank you so much for that. We also, other ideas that can work, and it have already been mentioned. Vince talked about classroom visits. I think Chelsea might have touched on that as well. Master classes, workshops. It doesn't have to be the entire orchestra. Just showing your face, showing up on a regular basis. And I think somebody already touched on it, not just during February, please, come all the time. Vicky, you guys are amazing. You do the petting zoos before, and maybe we can expand it. I know the space might be a little limited, but have petting zoos for adults. I know adults participate, but just really targeting adults. And then the last thing, and I'm going to wrap this up because I love this stuff. Advocacy. CCS can be the bridge over troubled waters, right? You can, there are plenty of things to be done. I love that CCS sets up a booth during the H Street Festival. You set up a booth. And anybody that walks by, you give them a flyer, you talk to them. I've seen these people, the representatives from the orchestra. You reach out, you're there. And I think that's just a simple, cheap way to show and be a voice and be in the space and with the people. Supporting organizations that are promoting classical music, like maybe put a little blurb about another organization, maybe a dance troupe in your program, and maybe sponsoring, have them serve offer them a space in the program to be highlighted in the program. And then I'm wrapping it up. I'm so excited. Small groups that can play, you already do that. I know that. Social media posts, advertising, other groups' concerts. Oh, how is there, there are so many stages in our area. The more we can help each other, the better we will all be. The better we will all be. And then last, I got this one driving today. Have a local celebrity MC a concert and give maybe a short speech about an organization that they enjoy, or have it just before intermission or after intermission. Of course not during, because we want to have everybody's attention. So just having the community actually be a part. These are, and I have more. I could do my own webinar. I have more, but just having CCS, who is already, you know, you're already working towards it, but just having us, like you saying, more meaningfully engaged. Okay, so those are just a few ideas, and there are a lot more things that we can do, and I think we're leading to going on the right path with the conversation.
I love you, Veronica. So I love that, you know, we've worked our way around to, you know, sort of a very specific local, which is of great interest to us for CCS. I know that we have people joining us from all around the country, so I want to kind of bring things back really quickly where I started them, to Vince and our conversations that we had, many of them leading up to this. Vince kept saying, you've got to speak to your community. You've got to be whatever it is that you do in response to this crisis and to any events, it has to be related to your community. And Vince, I know you've had some discussions with other orchestras where you've been about, you know, initiatives that they've had reaching out in their community. Is there anything that you've seen that small arts organizations could study or learn from, or have you generally found that they've been too disingenuous or thoughts there?
I'm gonna leave that to Veronica because she's on the trail on that question. But you know, but what I will say is just sort of, you know, a couple of things. Number one, I think we are in a point, particularly with Black Lives Matter, that advocacy is archaic. We're in a time of activism. We're not asking permission. We're telling you what you need, what we need. If you want my entertainment dollar, I need to see more people who look like me. Because if not, there's other places I can go on a Friday night. I can sit at home and pay a stream and watch Berlin Philharmonic on my TV and have a great sound system, right? You know, and drink beer and wine and be happy and merry for the rest of the weekend, right? The other thing too, in relation to that, because what I have seen is this, typically it's, you know, the corporate mindset disease must go. And it's activism that's going to be the cure. What do I mean by that? The corporate mindset, as we've seen in public education, really is about top-down decisions, right? It's about dictating what happens here, right? Not getting the input of people who are on the ground. And so typically what happens is it's about power and control. And what I have seen, like in Charleston, we did wonderful gospel Christmas Pops concert year after year after year after year. And initiatives like that, which really made a lot of inroads, not only with a segment of the community that was not presented in the audience, but also even the traditional audiences were like, hey, this is a new sound. Let me kind of come up here and do this next January or February or whatever it is. The idea is that, but when something becomes too successful in the corporate mind disease, it becomes a threat. And when it becomes a threat, it means that I can no longer control the narrative that I'm telling you. How many times I've heard a president and CEO say, I don't tell my board of directors everything. And how many times I've run across a board of director members who says, I'm asking questions and I'm not getting the answers that I need. So what's happening is sometimes these really highly successful entities become minimized, right? And then money gets channeled out of this pot and it gets put over here, right? And so we got a major issue there. So I think, first of all, the corporate mentality needs to get out of the arts as it needs to get out of public education. is no place, okay? We've seen where it goes. And that's why I said activism is going to be the answer to that. Advocacy is a nice way of trying to justify and asking you what I need. That's number one. Number two, what I have seen is MLK concerts, Black History Month, that's so old. That's just archaic. Because the only time I got an invite for podium work was MLK, Black History. Okay, well, you know, I've studied Beethoven, Tchaikovsky, Brahms, and all those other, how come I'm not good for that? That's archaic, all right? How can we be more inclusive and expand those? Although those entities are also very well attended, the question begins, how can we move aspects of what is successful over here to what is not, right? And I think the other thing too, and the other thing too is when we talk about having people on stage who look like you, what that does, particularly in the era that we are now, Black Lives Matter, you know, when you have cultural differences on stage, you need to be careful to ensure that you have workplace protections, number one. And number two, because if you're going to reflect your community, you can't have folks up there talking anti-homophobic slurs, and yet you get money from the gay and lesbian transgender community. Something ain't right, okay? So we need more accountability, okay? And that's why I said activism is the answer. Advocacy is gone. And so I forgot where I was going. Oh yeah, part of culture presence for me was I decided to grow dreadlocks. You would have thought that World War III was about ready to start and that the Russians were going to bomb all of Memphis in the Mid-South region. Give me a freaking break. And we now live in a time where there are states that have to enact legislations to protect people against from being discriminated because they have natural hairstyles. Well, the cultural difference then kind of opened up this whole can of worms and it just shocked everybody's reality. So a lot of things need to change. So one of the things I would say is keep being genuine about what you're doing. The one size fits all approach does not work. You have to take a look at what is unique to our community and how can we be a resource or how can we tap into or how can we be of help to what's going on in our community. And like I said, you got Veronica girl, so I ain't even worried about CCS doing what y'all got to do. Thank you. And that's I didn't mean to go that way.
That's fabulous. You know, we're so lucky to have this wonderful array of people who've trained musicians from a very young age to quite a ripe old age, people who are creating and interpreting music in many, many different settings. I guess, first of all, I want to throw it back really quickly. We're bumping up against the end of our time here. Does anybody have anything that they've been dying to piggyback on from all that's been said that's been so, so fantastic? Anybody want to chime in before we look to questions from the audience?
I was going to just answer one question from the audience real quick, just kind of address it. There's a question from Sarah Josie about inclusiveness at the time of COVID. What can we do as effective virtual programming? What are we going to do with these upcoming semesters? I think that's a very good question. I think it's going to be providing content online, creative ways of providing content online until we can get into the schools. And probably, you know, the education concerts of having schools to come to the concert halls, that might be out for a while, maybe for a season or two. So this may be an opportunity for us to take small groups into the schools. It's going to be a bit different for the next few years.
We've got some amazing questions in the Q&As, and each one of them practically could take an entirely different webinar. We want to be clear here at CCS that we are really very much hoping that this is the beginning of a continuing conversation. So if we're not able to answer any of your questions, or if we don't give them their due today, we hope that we can continue to engage with this. I'll throw a couple of excellent questions that I'm seeing here. One is advice for classical music organizations looking to expand representation of people of color in their membership. And we also have a question about predominantly white organizations looking to expand and to perform pieces that are deemed specific to Black cultural tradition, and how to avoid accusation of appropriation. So two different questions, very big questions. Just a few minutes left.
Appropriations in terms of, is it mean interpretation or appropriations in terms of funding?
I
was kind of wondering.
Maybe Dr. Jones.
I think Dr. Jones was going to raise his hand.
Go ahead.
You're muted, Dr. Jones.
Now, okay, sorry. Cultural appropriation is I think, a very dangerous word. We, as conductors, are always conducting repertoire from Russian, from Polish, to Germans, to South Americans, to Mexicans, to Chinese. We can't be all of those people. And what we do is that we take the integrity of our art form and we prepare that music. We share it with our diverse audiences, and even though our ensembles may not be always diverse, at least we're helping them to know that there's a lot of incredible talent and skills and repertoire represented in all cultures. Those cultures can help teach us, but we also have a responsibility to find other music besides our own. I once had someone tell me that when I was in Austria, only Austrians should play Mozart. Oh, well, that's very interesting. That leaves out a whole lot of the world. but I thought that was one of the first times people said, you know, you can't do this. It's one thing to put on costumes and to pretend you're something else beside what you are, but doing repertoire that has been created by other talents and other cultures, I think that's a necessity for us.
Anybody else want to tackle that question or briefly about the idea of expanding representation and leadership?
I've been asked to be a part of the board of an orchestra that doesn't have, I don't think there are any Blacks in the orchestra or any people of color in the orchestra. I thought long and hard about it, and I thought, well, there are no Black people in that group, or not even on the board. But then I decided, I am Black. I am there. And like Vince was saying, we got to have a seat at the table, and we have to be calm. We have to be cautiously optimistic. We have to be open as Black people to questions, and white people need to be they have to ask. If you don't know, please ask. The same way that you would study a Brahms, Beethoven, Mozart score, you're not going to go and do a gospel piece and without some understanding of how to perform it. So I just encourage white musicians or our allies to just ask. There's a wealth of knowledge all around us, and we can just ask.
That's fabulous. My friends, we are pushing up against our hour timing here. Lightning round, does anybody have any last words of wisdom to send us on our way tonight?
I just want to say again, thank you for putting this together. I got this from one of my conductor friends, Sarah Hicks. Know your why. Why are you doing what you're doing? And that will also help you to kind of focus what you're doing. I had a teacher to say, you don't need to reinvent the wheel every single time. Try to make the wheel better and try to do what is passionate to you. So know what your why is.
Fantastic. Thank you.
My wrap up is, we need to be very mindful on a very personal level, the effects that racism and oppression in general has on those of us who have to deal with this every single day. even though we are playing and we are engaging in an art form that really brings us pleasure, right? But that pleasure is sometimes threatened by perception and misconceptions. And so just because I'm smiling on the outside and I'm being very gracious and grateful to you does not mean all is well on the inside. And so I hope that we can get across, at least I would like to get across to all those listening, that the issue of self-care, the issue of internalized oppression, the issues of internalized racism, particularly as we are in this movement that we are experiencing, Black people are traumatized. There are people who are abused, who are constantly having to work under their abusers. We need to be mindful that self-care is of paramount. Taking care of my spirit, taking care of my mental health, my physical health, and having people in my life that, quite frankly, I can let it out when I need to without shame.
Thank you. Dr. Jones, Carlos, Veronica, final word.
I guess I'll say, Dr. Jones, please.
No, I was just going to say, there was an interesting thing that I saw as attributed to former President Richard Nixon, oddly enough. But he was sort of an amateur piano player, and he said, if you want to make beautiful music, then you have to play the black and white notes together.
It's great.
Nixon, I thought that was pretty good. I'll leave it with that. Thank you very much, Victoria.
I guess my words of closing is, I heard a researcher say, who gets to tell the story? This process of reckoning begins with telling the whole story. Telling the whole story. Do your research. Ask for support and guidance. We're here, we want people to perform music by African American composers. We want African American soloists to be highlighted. We want these things, and that's all we're asking. We're here. So just open your mind and just think broader, think outside of the box, and certainly reach out to your community that is already there. Thank you so much, Vicki, for doing this. You are a person, my husband says all the time, you are what you do. And knowing you for 20 years was the 20 plus years, that because I have known you, and it is why I just jump at the chance to be anywhere you are. So thank you for your vision, and you've always been this. So again, you are a model of what an ally should be doing. You are a model ally. Thank you for this opportunity to share, and to this awesome panel. My goodness, I'm quite excited, as you can tell.
Carlos.
Yeah, it's hard act to follow there. But I will say that, you know, along with Chelsea, I'd say, you know, it's important to understand why, and understanding that we're here in this moment here to hopefully make our organizations better and long-term our society better. But, you know, it's always helpful to understand the impact of what we do today and how it will affect future generations, because we're showing the future generations how they should act, how they should respond to cultural changes. And so I think it's broader, you know, than what this moment here. We have to keep going. So thank you so much for having me, and it's a pleasure.
Thank you. And you know what? We will keep going. Specifically, we're going to keep going tomorrow on Facebook and on our website. Margaret, I think this is going to be available on our website. Is that right?
Yeah. So I know a few people have asked. We'll have this recording up on our website and Facebook page tomorrow. So please do share with anyone that you think would find this to be a helpful resource. And I know we didn't get to everyone's questions. I'm taking note of them, and I'll email them to the panelists. So if there's more that we can help respond to online, we'd love to do that. And I'll also email everyone that registered a link to the recording, and also a few donation links for for those who are looking to also, put their money towards these anti-racist causes. So.
And perhaps we can continue some of this specific conversation, you know, in the Facebook comments when it goes up. But
yeah, absolutely.
Thank you all so much. You have enriched my life immensely. I'm participating in this all of our lives, and I can't tell you how much I value you and what you've brought to us and what you bring to the world. So thank you to each of you.
Thank you. Thank you, Margaret. Thank you, everybody.
Bye. Thanks, everyone. Have a great night.